me to talk about ways to save golf is Brendan Elliott. He's with the Little Linksters Association for Junior Golf Development. Good to see you once again, Brendan. He's been on the show with us before. And also PGA Master Professional John Hughes. John, welcome to the show. Good to see you. You know, let's start with the problems that you guys see in the golf industry right now. We'll talk about ways to save it in just a bit. John, your course is all over Central Florida here. What are some of the problems you're seeing out there?
The biggest problem I see is perception. We're living in somewhat of a negative culture, and there's a lot of great things going on in golf right now. The PGA Performance Track recently showed us that rounds are up 3.5% over last year.
Is it really?
So there's positive things going on. I think the biggest thing we see from a section standpoint of view, because I do see a lot of courses from around the North Florida section, is more positive things going on. What are the positive things? And I think if we start focusing on those things, golf doesn't necessarily need to be saved. We just need to preserve it.
I have a problem sometimes when people say the golf is dying, we need to change it, because I'm a golf lover. I love it. Do you change a sport to meet today's needs or demands and then lose a little bit of what it means? That's one of the big issues I struggle with. What do you think, Brendan?
You have to evolve. Not necessarily change, because it's a rich tradition with the game, and people enjoy that. They love that. That's one of the special things about golf. But we have to evolve, or else the sport will die. And I think there's a lot of good initiatives through the PGA of America, other organizations, on trying to keep the game alive and make it fun for today's generation, not just kids, but for adults too.
Do you think maybe it's changed from, I remember when I was growing up, you know, my dad, my grandpa, they would go out and spend 4 or 5 hours after work golfing. There's no way I could ever get by with that now. Have we changed as a society to where, you know, going out for a full day of golf is kind of frowned upon in some ways? Do you see that?
Certainly, and it's the evolution of any industry that you have to evolve with the changing times, and I think that's what you're seeing golf do right now, whether it's shorter holes or shorter lengths of time, getting more families involved, which when you talk about your father and grandfather, that is what was going on. Your family was involved.
Right.
So I think you're going to see more of that going forward, not only from a bigger perspective trickling down, but more so from the grassroots efforts. There's a lot of courses in this general area that are doing a lot of grassroots family-oriented programs that's restructuring and evolving with the changing times.
Yeah, you deal with a lot of kids getting into golf. Is that the key, is making it fun for the kids? So that they spend time with mom and dad.
I think
maybe.
If you focus on the kids for the long term, it'll draw in the families and the parents and more adults, even the grandparents. So I think that's a very important thing for people to focus on as a youth.
Some of the articles that I've read, you know, everybody's blaming something different, right? It's nobody has stepped up since Tiger Woods was the big star. You know, when Tiger came roaring to the top, you got all these young people interested. I think there are a lot of stars out there in golf right now. Are they not resonating with younger people? You see younger people all the time. Do they want to be some of these newer guys, a Jordan Spieth or some of the others, a Bubba Watson? Or are they still saying, I want to be Tiger?
They still aspire to be Tiger. We hear about Tiger a lot.
Isn't that funny? But he's not a young guy anymore. When we were talking about he's played at the Masters, 20 years? He's an old guy almost, like us.
But when you're as recognizable as a figure as he is and has become over the years, it's going to always be that. But, you know, the young guys, Jordan Spieth, Ricky Fowler, even Bubba Watson, the kids want to be like these guys.
Yeah, guys like Ricky Fowler. I mean, that's, to me, he's an exciting young guy to watch, but for some reason it's not translating. Why do you think that is?
It has a lot to do with charisma and the identification that you're able to engage with that particular player. And a lot of golf has become somewhat sterile, I guess is a great way of putting it. When you have a charismatic person like a Tiger or a Ricky, it's easier to identify with them, and it's easier to follow them and want to become part of that culture. And I think what you'll see over time is a little bit more charismatic people. Jordan Spieth is very charismatic. It's just the clips you see him so focused.
Right.
And if more people saw how these pros are off the course and realize what kind of people they are, and that they do have a sense of humor, they do have a personality.
I think the PGA is doing a good job with that too. They're putting these guys, you know, driving cars, driving grandma. So they're trying. The PGA knows they got to reach out, don't they?
Absolutely. And that's coming from all different directions, whether it's the PGA Tour, the PGA of America, National Golf Foundation. It is about having people understand they're just not a talking head or a a robot swinging a golf club. They are people that can be very much identified with.
We're going to talk more about this in just a second. 150 some courses every year. The I think USGA, I think, was saying we're going to see golf courses go out 150 a year and only 10 to 20 opening. We're going to talk about what you're seeing here in Central Florida coming up. Much more straight ahead here on Orlando Matters, the future of golf.